We want to continue from where we left off last week. Last week, we were talking about building to last. And today, we are still talking about building to last. So I'll do the concluding part, which is actually longer than the beginning. So what are we saying? We said last week that we can only build to last if we have a close relationship with God, because we need to hear from God what our life's work is supposed to be. Our life's work is what we're calling the land that God will show you. What must we commit to? And then we have to trust God and move into that particular role. We shouldn't take any option that looks cheaper, faster, easier. That would be going to Egypt. But we are not going to Egypt. We want to be in the land that God has told us to be in. And once you move in, the Bible says Isaac sowed in that land. Isaac worked in that land. So you have to begin to work in your field. When you work, you will see the blessing. The Bible says in the same year that he sowed, he received a hundredfold blessing. So a hundredfold blessing is waiting for your action. God is with us and God is determined to help us, but we have also to be determined to do what God has told us to do. So we want to build to last. And because we want to build to last, there are additional things we need to do apart from hearing from God and sowing in the land. Genesis chapter 26, verses 17 to 22. Genesis 26, 17 to 22 says, "Then Isaac departed from there and pitched his tent in the valley of Gera and dwelt there. And Isaac dug again the wells of water, which they had dug in the days of Abraham his father, for the Philistines had stopped them up after the death of Abraham. He called them by the names which his father had called them. Also, Isaac's servant dug in the valley and found a well of running water there. But the herdsmen of Gera quarreled with Isaac's herdsmen, saying, 'The water is ours.' So he called the name of the well Esek, because they quarreled with him. Then they dug another well, and they quarreled over that one also. So he called its name Sitna. And he moved from there and dug another well, and they did not quarrel over it. So he called its name Rehoboth, because he said, 'For now the Lord has made room for us, and we shall be fruitful in the land.'" Amen. Amen. So we see that Isaac was facing opposition. When you are working in the land God has shown you, there will still be opposition. Some people already in the land may become jealous of you. You might decide that God has called me into ministry, or God has called me into medicine, or God has called me into hairdressing. Some people are already hairdressers. Some people are already doctors. Some people are already pastors. So you might face opposition from people who are already there because they become jealous of you. Sometimes we think that if we see opposition, it is a sign that we are out of the will of God. But opposition is not an indication that you are outside the will of God. Jesus himself was always opposed, although he was always in the will of God. Jesus was opposed. He faced so much opposition, the opposition drove him to his death, but he was in the will of God. So I just want to assure you that just because people are against what you are doing does not mean that what you are doing is against the will of God. Isaac was in the will of God. Jesus was in the will of God. Yet they faced opposition. So when we face opposition as believers, it is important for us to persist. But the only way you'll be sure and persist is if you are confident of what you know for a fact God has told you to do. That is why you have to hear God for yourself. If you only hear God when someone prophesies to you, you only hear God when someone says, "I see," then you are going to have a problem when you face opposition, because you didn't hear it, you didn't see it. So why will you do it? You won't do it. But if you know for a fact that this is what God has told me, then don't let the world stopper stop you. Don't let the mean boss stop you. Don't let the biased lecturer stop you. Determined to be unstoppable. Determined to be unstoppable. You have to unstop the wells. The Bible says that Isaac unstopped the wells that had been stopped and gave them the same names. There are people who will not benefit from frustrating you, but they are frustrating you so you will not benefit from your own effort. What is the use of blocking a well? It is water. If you don't want Isaac to drink it, you can drink it yourself. But they decide, you want to drink it, we won't drink it either. Nobody is going to benefit from this skill. Nobody is going to benefit from this talent. Nobody is going to benefit from this revelation. Those people are what I call blockers. But what did Isaac do when blockers attacked him? He refused to be distracted. The Bible says he dug the wells again. He dug the wells again. So when people determine to oppose you, when they determine to go against what you know will help you to achieve the will of God, you have to dig the wells again to be sure that, as for me, I know this is what God wants me to benefit from, so I'm going to keep doing it. Focus on what you must gain, not on what other people are doing to slow you down. As a believer, you have to learn to ignore your enemies. Ignore them. Isaac didn't fight with them. Isaac didn't respond to them. Isaac simply dug the wells again. Are you ready to dig your wells again? And then there are the thieves. They took away his wells. Isaac had dug the wells and they seized the wells. They said, the thing is for me. You know the thing is not for you. How can it be for you? You never dug. So if you didn't dig, it's not yours. You are a thief. But even when the thieves attacked him, Isaac just moved somewhere else and dug another one. So don't let thieves stop you. If someone takes your promotion, don't decide I'm quitting. Don't quit. Continue to work. Work hard. Your time will come. What is due you will be given to you. Someone took your fiancé, so if you decided you won't date again, please date somebody else. Someone else will love you. Someone else will be faithful to you. But don't allow any thief that has taken your well away to stop you. Refuse to be stopped. What should have been yours may have been taken away. But you need to stick to God's instruction. Don't stop. If you don't stop, your wells will be unstopped. The Bible says that after people blocked his wells, that means after people delayed his blessing, after people took his wells, that means after he obeyed God, but it looked like a wasted effort, because he continued to dig, God gave him his own well. But why didn't God give him his own well from day one? You have told Isaac to live in the land, he's living in the land. So just give him his own well. Why let him go through and stopping wells, losing wells, before he gets his own well? But you see, when you are a new person at work, they don't make you the manager. They don't make you the boss. When you are a new student in a school, they don't make you school prefect. You have to prove yourself. And I think as believers, we have to come to the place where we understand that we have to prove ourselves to God. We have to show God that we will obey Him. We have to show God that we will follow. We have to show God that we trust Him. We must be obedient, full stop. And when you are obedient in that way, when you can show God that He can trust you, that you are dependable, the Bible says He will give you your own well. I want you to say to yourself, my own well is coming. My own well is coming. And you see, in the end, Isaac had a victory. People may not like what you are doing. They might not support you. They might not cheer you on. They might go out of their way to make it more difficult for you, like trying to get a permit from the ministries. They will make it more difficult than it's supposed to be. Tell you it costs three times what it's supposed to cost. But people are not the issue. The issue is, are we willing to persist? As long as we are following the instruction of God, we have to understand that fruitfulness is coming our way. Our day of fruitfulness will come. The Bible says when Isaac got his own well, he began to be fruitful in the land. So you will have your own well. You will have your own wealth. You will have your own blessing. You will have your own means of becoming more fruitful. Yes, God will enter that industry and he will create a need that only you can meet. A need that he has given only you the insight, the understanding, the wisdom, the ability to solve. And that is how God will make room for you in that land. So whatever land God is showing you, I want you to know that he will make room for you. You will not go into that land and find that it is choked. There are too many doctors, there are too many teachers, there are too many hairdressers, there are too many seamstresses, there are too many builders. Oh no, God will make room for you. In the building industry, he will make room for you. In acting, he will make room for you. In singing, he will make room for you. In whatever ministry he has called you to, God will make room for you. Let us read Genesis 26, verses 23 to 25. Genesis 26, 23 to 25. Then he went up from there to Beersheba. And the Lord appeared to him the same night and said, I am the God of your father Abraham. Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bless you and multiply your descendants for my servant Abraham's sake. So he built an altar there and called on the name of the Lord. And he pitched his tent there, and there Isaac's servants dug a well. Isaac's servants dug a well. Isaac's servant dug a well. You see, Isaac, the Bible says, by this point, he had started to see money. He had already planted and reaped 100-fold. He had already unstopped his father Abraham's wells, which means that his flocks were well watered. He had already dug new wells himself. So his herds were multiplying, his flocks were multiplying, his crops were multiplying, his household was wealthy. He was probably even supplying water to other people and making money. Yet he maintained a relationship with God. The Bible says God appeared to Isaac. God doesn't appear to just anybody. If God appeared to Isaac, that means that Isaac was still holy. Isaac was still praying. Isaac was still declaring his dependence on God. And therefore, God appeared to Isaac. Isaac was increasing in prosperity, but Isaac was still maintaining a relationship with God. The scripture says Isaac built an altar. If Isaac built an altar, then Isaac still saw God as a source. Money did not become Isaac's God. Isaac did not make himself his own God. God was still the God of Isaac. When you begin to prosper in the land, when God begins to make you fruitful in the land, will you become your own God? Will God still be your God? Or will you be too rich for God, too wise for God, too educated for God, too fruitful for God? What will happen when you begin to prosper in the land? What will happen when you begin to increase in the land? Because if what we are building, we want it to last, then what we are building must not take us away from God. We need to check our hearts. We are building to last. Therefore, we must have a heart that is always in love with God. There is a place for creating wealth and a place for worshiping God. Your pursuit of wealth, your pursuit of increase, your pursuit of fruitfulness must not remove your worship, must not reduce your affection for God, must not end your service to God. Many believers become ex-believers when they become wealthy. People will come to church in the rain if they have to take trotro, if they have to walk, if they have to beg somebody for a ride. But when that same person has a car, when it rains, they won't come to church because they don't want mud on their wheel flaps. So believers become ex-believers because of money. You see, God will give you money. God's intention is to prosper you. If anybody tells you God is not interested in you being wealthy, the person is lying. God is very interested in you being wealthy. God wants you to be wealthy. But you and I, we have to make that commitment that no matter how rich I become, God, I will serve you. And actually, the richer I become, the more I will serve you. Because we all say to whom much is given, much is expected, isn't it? So if God gives you much riches, then God should expect from you much worship. We must never use our wealth. We must never use money. We must never use the pursuit of riches as a reason not to worship God. We are in the business of worshiping God long before we are in the business of farming or sowing or nursing or whatever business we are in. Our first business is the business of what? Worshiping God. Now, verses 28 to 32 of the same Genesis 26, it says that, "But they said, we have certainly seen that the Lord is with you. So we said, let there now be an oath between us, between you and us, and let us make a covenant with you, that you will do us no harm, since we have not touched you, and since we have done nothing to you but good, and have sent you away in peace. You are now the blessed of the Lord." So he made them a feast, and they ate and drank. Then they arose early in the morning, and swore an oath with one another. And Isaac sent them away, and they departed from him in peace. It came to pass the same day that Isaac's servants came and told him about the well which they had dug, and said to him, "We have found water." So he called it Shebna. Therefore the name of the city is Beersheba to this day. Amen. Amen. Isaac is still continuing in his business. What God told him to do, he is still doing it. And to be able to do it, he has to what? Dig wells. So at every punctuation mark in Isaac's story, the Bible points out Isaac dug a well, Isaac dug a well, Isaac dug a well, Isaac dug a well. Isaac has been digging wells to such an extent that now Isaac's enemies are testifying and they are saying, "You are blessed of the Lord." His enemies are calling him the blessed of the Lord. His enemies are calling him the blessed of the Lord. His enemies have changed the name they gave Isaac. Now they are saying that we can see your new name. Your real name is the blessed of the Lord. Why did his enemies change their behavior towards him, their attitude towards him? Why did his enemies give this testimony? His enemies are giving this testimony because Isaac continues to hear from God. Isaac continues to do the work God has told him to do. Isaac continues to persist in the work in spite of opposition. Isaac continues to worship the Lord. He's keeping his faith. And as he is doing that, he is increasing in blessing so much that even his enemies are testifying. So is it only Isaac? Or are we not also Abraham's seed? You and I, according to Galatians, we are Abraham's seed. That means that what God had in store for Isaac is what he has in store for me, is what he has in store for you. Why? Because we are Abraham's seed. We are heirs of the promise. What God intends to do with our lives is beyond our understanding. If we knew what God wanted to do with us, we'd be rushing, seeking His will, seeking His face, so that we can get with the program. Because I need to get with the program so that even my enemies will start calling me Nia Yehowa Eshirano, will start calling me the blessed of the Lord. But if I am not in line with the will of God, if I have not found the right land to sow in, how will I hear this testimony from my enemies? So we are all starting our fast on Thursday. Some people are campaigning to start on Monday, but we are all starting our fast on Thursday. And when we start this fast, I want you to take some time to take stock of your life. And I want you to start to ask God to tell you clearly, where is that land He wants you to sow in? Where is that industry He wants you to establish your business in? Where is that company He wants you to work for? Where is that vision He wants you to pursue? What is it? What is it? During this fast, you need to see. You need to hear. You need to see. You need to hear. And give God your time. We are fasting, so there is nothing else to do but to pray. So seek the face of God and let God speak to you. You want to pray for courage. You want to pray for the strength to move there. Because it took courage for Isaac to decide, I won't go to Egypt in the midst of a famine. It took courage. It took a lot of self-discipline to see everybody else going and saying, hey, okay, Isaac, you are still sitting here. You want to die? And for him to say, I won't die. And everybody is going and he's wondering, am I sure? Maybe I will die. But he stayed. He stayed. And we want to pray for that staying power. We want to pray that we will not be lazy. The Bible says Isaac sowed in the land. Sowing is work, is farming. And farming work is not easy work. Farming work is hard work. But Isaac did the hard work. Sometimes as believers, we are unfortunately lazy. We don't want to do hard work. We want to say, oh, I've prayed about it, it is done. The Bible didn't say Isaac only built altars. Isaac also dug wells. Isaac didn't only build altars. Isaac also sowed in the land. So during this fast, we are going to pray for new zeal, so that we'll work harder. We must do more. We have not done enough. Don't deceive yourself. I know I have not done enough. And I know you have not done enough. Because if we have done more than enough, we should see more than we are seeing. But if we look at our lives and we are dissatisfied, then we have not sowed enough. If you don't sow more seed, you won't reap a big harvest. If Isaac had sowed only one grain of corn in the land, I don't think you'll be talking about harvesting hundredfold. You won't even be talking about harvest. So don't say, they said we should sow. They didn't say how much to sow. One corn, two is sowing. One corn is not sowing. When somebody tells you sow in the land, they are not looking for one corn. They are looking for one plot. They are looking for 10 plots. They are looking for 50 plots. 100 acres of land. Now you've sowed in the land. But sowing one seed, please. We need to work hard. We need to get a new revelation of work. Believers, we must work. And then you have to pray against being discouraged. Sometimes it's not that we are not working hard. Sometimes our spirit is sad. Our soul is unhappy because there's so much opposition against us. You do the work, somebody takes the credit. That is the people who are stealing the world saying it's for me. You do the work, the credit goes to somebody. You do the work, you don't get the benefit. You do the work, somebody just messes it up. And you're like, what am I even supposed to be doing in this life? I will tell you, you are supposed to be persistent. You are supposed to refuse to quit. You are supposed to prove to God that when He tells you to go, man cannot make you stop. When God tells you to go, man cannot make you stop. Prove it. So pray against discouragement. The Bible says of the psalmist that he encouraged himself.
When nobody was telling him, it's okay, God will come through for you, he told himself, it's okay, God will come through for me. He did it himself. So we have to pray against discouragement, because discouragement can stop your blessing. And refuse to lose your faith. Don't just look around you. And because of some small money you got in January, because of some small breakthrough you got in March in spite of Corona, now you think that you don't need God. You don't need the church. I don't need a sermon. I know what I'm doing. I can do it on my own. The Bible says Isaac built an altar. He built a permanent system of worship. Worship became a permanent feature in his life. The richer he became, the more he was looking for an altar to build. Now, he didn't worship on Abraham's altars anymore. Abraham built several altars. But when Isaac became prosperous in the land, he said, now I know God for myself. Let me have a direct relationship with him myself. So as you proceed, as you prosper, you need to know God for yourself. The most important thing also is that we have to be obedient to our calling. Obedience will release the sort of blessing that even our enemies will testify of. Sometimes we are not prospering, not because we are not working hard, but because we are working hard at the wrong thing. When the doctor is a nurse, no number of shifts is going to make you the wealthy doctor you are supposed to be. Because first of all, you are not a doctor. You chose to be a nurse. So we have to be true to our calling so that the correct blessing and level of blessing will be released into our lives. May those who have opposed you in your career, those who have opposed you in your search for wealth, may you rise to the level where they will call you the blessed of the Lord. Yes, let us release that blessing. So what am I saying today? This evening, what I want to say is that there is a specific place that God wants you to be. In order for you to fulfill your destiny, there's a specific place for you to be. And you need to spend time with God and find out where that place is. Find out who you are supposed to be there with. And then you need to move there and invest yourself. Invest in that area. If you know God wants you to be a singer, invest in some training. Invest in voice training. Invest in learning an instrument. Invest in studying about the technical aspects of music. But just invest in the sector, because you know this is where God has called you to be. So know it, invest in it. And when you know it and you invest in it, start working in it. Don't be in planning stage forever. Take a step. Take a step. And even if you take a step and you lose, just like Isaac dug wells and lost them, it doesn't matter. If you lose the first well, you will get the second well. If you lose the second well, you will get the third well. Don't let one loss in your business. Oh, and I started the company and I ran out of money and I closed it down and it has remained closed. Hey, it can't remain closed. Because the Bible says that Isaac unstopped the wells. So if you have closed your business, please unstop the business. Reopen it. Reopen it. Reopen it. Because he reopened the wells. So you must reopen your business. You must reopen that dream. You must reopen that school. You must reopen that thing that you know God asked you to do. And you started and you stopped. Restart. Restart. Because read again is restarting. Read again is reopening. Read again is beginning again. So start to do that work again. You see, God uses work as a means of blessing. It's only when Isaac dug the wells, it's only when Isaac planted the seed that he received the blessing. So we need to do it again. And as you do it again, and continue to do it, the Bible says that God will make room for you. And don't let anybody stop you before there is room for you. Because if they stop you before there is room, you will never enter your rest. You must enter your rest. You must find your Rehoboth. You must. So keep moving until you see that, this is my area in the industry. Then you've settled. And as God increases you in wealth, increase in your worship. Your wealth should be equal. Your level of worship must match your level of wealth. And our level of wealth is only going to increase. Therefore, our level of worship must consistently increase. Don't allow your level of worship to go down. Where we are today is the lowest level of worship we must ever be. Because this is the lowest level of wealth we will ever be. Amen? Amen? We are moving up. Amen. And the Lord wants to bless you to the point that your enemies want to be your friends. So start doing what he has asked you to do so that the blessing will fall in Jesus' name. Amen.